we left you yesterday with the final judgment that hits Belshazzar the king, who absolutely did not learn from his dad, Nebuchadnezzar. He didn't honor God in any way. He had no respect for God. In fact, he excluded God and Daniel. Daniel's only brought in to interpret this kind of very strange event of this hand that God, isn't God amazing? He sends this hand to write on a wall, this condemnation. I mean, he's making a point to all generations. You wonder why God is so dramatic sometimes, so that you'll take notice. Mm. So we take notice.
Yes.
And this hand writes, and it ends up being, you know, your reign is over. It's done.
Right.
And you're done.
Yeah.
And your kingdom that you led is done.
Yeah.
And so all of these done's, not on the good side.
No.
And then the very final verse of chapter 5 is this. It says, or last two verses, that very night Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain. And Darius the Mede took over the kingdom at the age of 62.
Right.
So we have a king turnover. We have a kingdom turnover. Mm-hmm. And this guy has just experienced God's judgment.
Right.
And, you know, that's really scary stuff.
It is.
You know, to talk about the judgment of God is not the nicest subject in the world, but it's necessary because it paints God for who he really is.
Yes.
He's holy. We're not.
That's right.
He's righteous. He's pure. Mm-hmm. He's pure love. He is. He's pure holiness. He's pure justice. See, we only get what we deserve.
Yes.
This guy's getting what he deserves in the courts of heaven.
That's right.
Justice comes out of heaven. Mm-hmm. Man's justice moves. He takes sin, and man tends to do this with it, right? We talked about it yesterday a bit. But man tends to take sin and through excuse and blaming, lessens sin's impact and tries to find peace through lessening it through excusing and blaming.
Absolutely. You try to justify a sin so that you can continue in it and try to find a way to experience peace in that. But there can't be. There cannot be peace. As long as you are living in sin and trying to excuse and blame it away, you will not experience peace.
You can't, because you're disconnected from the source of peace.
That's exactly right.
And so, like, there's this incredible thing that Christ does for us, his work. And we're going to go back to Romans 8:34 because it's got four things that Christ does for us. And we're just going to scratch the surface tonight, kind of get you thinking down the work of Christ. And we talked about some of this on Sunday, but let's reread this. Mm-hmm. Who then is the one who condemns? And then the answer is given too. So the question is asked and the answer is given so that we don't get it wrong.
That's right.
Who then is the one who condemns? No one. We don't condemn.
Yeah.
We're not here to condemn.
That's right.
We aren't here to condemn people. The woman's brought to Jesus, right?
Yeah.
She had been caught in the act of adultery. It always amazed me, you know, why didn't they bring the man?
Yes, exactly.
But that just tells you how far from justice they really were.
Absolutely.
They had no sense of justice.
None.
This was not heaven's justice.
No. Otherwise, they wouldn't be bringing her forward.
But they bring her to the King of Heaven who brings justice and mercy.
Yes.
And it's a beautiful thing. It ends up being a beautiful thing because he points out these guys' sins and said, if you're without sin, throw the first stone.
That's right.
Talk about exposure. This is like those magazines at the checkout.
That's right. Exactly. Boom. Laid bare. And the question and answer are right. Who among us can condemn? We will all be, if we go back to these scales, we will all be weighed and found wanting.
We are all under condemnation.
Absolutely.
And only one that gets us out of it is he who was condemned for us.
That's right.
Christ.
That's right.
What a beautiful thing. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Like, it's absolutely stunning when it grips you a little bit that Jesus, you were condemned for me. Thank you. What else do I say?
Yeah.
Because without you, I'm standing with a short scale.
I'm Belshazzar.
I am.
Yeah.
I'm no different. I fall short.
That's right.
That's Romans, by the way, 3:23.
That's right. We all fall short.
We all fall short of the glory of God, the perfection of God.
That's right.
And so, like, tonight, like, we want you to kind of think your way through this verse. We're not here to condemn the world.
No.
We're not here to condemn the woman hauled before. We're not here to stone people.
No.
Right?
We're not in that position.
No. When we talk about sin, it's from a humble basis of grace. Paul says, "There but for the grace of God go I."
Okay. Yeah.
He recognized he was a sinner, and it's only the grace of God that's differentiated him from anything.
Absolutely. This is, again, not anything we've done. When people, you know, "Oh, you're a Christian, you think you're so great." Not at all. You know, as
In fact,
Paul
I've come
says,
to terms I'm not.
That's right.
I'm great. The only thing I'm great about, I'm greatly loved.
I love that. That's exactly right. This is not our works. It couldn't be.
It just can't be.
It could only be because of him. He's the one who paid the price. He was condemned for our sins.
That's it right there, Ange. And I don't know about you, but my heart's beating a little faster as I think about this incredible work of Christ.
I'm glad we're talking through this. Yeah.
And then we've got kind of four little windows to look through on his work.
Yes.
In this same verse. And the first work, everybody, you know, all of you as Christians, you're very familiar with, and that is that Christ Jesus who died. Hmm. Okay, that was his work first.
Yes.
He came, he was born to die, literally.
He was
born to be condemned.
Yes.
To be treated as a sinner.
That's right. Yeah, when we were studying Philippians and talking about, you know, Jesus was fully God, could have chosen to just stay in his kingship.
Yes.
And all that came with that. And he came as a true example of a servant's heart in full servanthood to serve us and be condemned for our sins.
In fact, the Bible says he laid all of that down, that he could carry out this work for us. So he actually gave it up to carry out this work.
Absolutely.
So he's born to die. Mm-hmm. He lives in a way that brings truth and the message of this balance of justice and mercy.
That's right.
He never compromises justice, the holiness of God, or the justice of heaven.
Absolutely.
In fact, it's the justice of heaven that he's come to honor.
Yes.
And he's going to die because the justice of heaven matters.
And requires it.
It absolutely requires it.
Yes.
And he's gonna fulfill what the justice requires, because the law condemns us. You see, it's the law that condemns us.
Mm-hmm.
Christ doesn't condemn us. The law condemns us.
That's
You've
right.
been found short on the scale.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So the law says, you're condemned.
Yeah.
And he's going to come and he's going to take our condemnation on the cross, laying down his life, which is, if you read Romans 6:23, it says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So the wages of sin is death.
Yes.
Belshazzar paid that
he
wage.
Did. He
that,
had
He
to.
Got his wages.
He did. That was it. That was his final judgment. He paid the wages, death.
And because of Jesus, you didn't.
That's right. We're off the hook.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's stunning as we reflect on this.
Yeah.
So he looks after the wages for us, what we've earned. We've earned death.
Mm-hmm.
It's through Jesus Christ that we are set free.
That's right.
Then he goes to his next work. More than that, who was raised to life.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is interesting because people don't think about it this way.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about this.
Yeah.
So you share it.
Okay. So basically, if he had died, taken our sins to the grave, and hadn't been raised to life immediately, and we're still waiting on this resurrection, you know, we're waiting around for this to come, we don't fully understand this new life, right? His resurrection gave us this new life. We have this amazing, amazing testimony and amazing experience to draw on and to see this is the new life that we have in Christ.
Exactly.
The resurrection gave that to us.
And so we're not, see, if he's just in the grave still 2,000 years later, and we have to wait for his resurrection, he hasn't completed his work.
That's right.
But he completed the work by conquering death and being raised, thereby saying, "Hey, Ange, you can really live.
Yeah.
You see it?
Yeah.
I dominated hell and death. I have the keys to hell and to death.
Victory
I set you free
already.
From your sins, the wages, yeah. death, and I keeping you from an eternal hell, yeah. separation from God. No, no, you're with me.
Yeah.
He's finishing the work, mm-hmm. the death and the resurrection
right.
of Christ.
Holding nothing back from us.
He's completely, exactly. Then the third work is who was raised to life is at the right hand of God.
Mm.
Well, the right hand of God is a place of authority.
Right.
It's a place of power.
Right.
But it's a place of love.
Absolutely.
Because he was sent from the right hand of God.
That's right.
And so it's love and it's power.
Yes.
He's got the love for us mm-hmm. and he's got the power to deliver us.
That's right.
And he's reigning over everything against us.
Completely.
Everything
sovereign.
Against you right now.
Yeah.
The enemy, the kingdom, the darkness of the dark kingdom, everything and death to come. He reigns over it all.
Yeah.
And that's why being at the right hand of
that's
God.
That's the right hand.
Isn't that amazing?
It's amazing.
Just one more work, though.
The one more work is the interceding for us. That's
right.
how it ends. And isn't that just amazing to think of how he's at the right hand of God, interceding for us constantly, telling God about us. Asking God, you know, calling on him for us, like we are at his attention. He's
exactly.
interceding on our behalf.
Yes. And if he's interceding for you, that's kind of like a lawyer in a way.
Right.
Right? Kind of yeah. like this advocate too,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, this mediator.
It kind of has that feel to it.
Yeah.
He's interceding where he's talking to God about, yeah, our needs and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
And, but he's coming kind of to a court thing where it's the idea of, yeah, I paid for this, Dad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They are my sheep.
Yeah.
And that means that in interceding for you, he's like a lawyer that's constantly there. And if he's your lawyer in the courts of heaven, and he's actually the lawyer that paid your price, he's saying, yep, they're pure.
Yeah.
I made them pure.
Yeah.
My blood washed them.
No.
My blood washed them. And then he intercedes. It's beautiful. He's between us and what our wages should be.
Yeah.
His blood is between us and our wages. And it washes us. And it will change us. And one day we will be fully like him. I hope that brings you great hope and encouragement. Christ's work on your behalf. You are not left with a scale that needs anything more. He's got it all. God bless.